advances may pose an even greater risk, particularly where exposure is chronic, as in the night-long use of some electric blankets. Many things can suppress melatonin: nighttime exposure to bright light, alcohol, and even exercise. Furthermore, many medications reduce melatonin levels, especially when taken at night. They include aspirin, ibuprofen, and many antihypertensive agents, in particular the so-called beta blockers, and perhaps even Prozac. Interestingly, Dr. Norden, whilst promoting Prozac to some degree, is more interested in promoting the newer antidepressants Zoloft, Paxil, Luvol, and Ferzone, Wellbutrin, and Remeron. There are reasons for this, as becomes clear later on in the book. Continuing on in chapter 5, Dr. Norden gives some important information about the pineal, which is absent from the books that I learnt in medical school and absent from contemporary books on the brain in Monash University and published by the major publication houses. The serotonin connection. By converting serotonin, the pineal gland generates most of the brain's melatonin. Centuries ago, Descartes labeled the pineal the seat of the soul. Some Eastern philosophies consider it highly spiritual or mystical, associated with the so-called third eye. All of this suggests some of the intrigue surrounding the gland. By the 1800s, scientists knew that a particularly elaborate blood vessel system favored the pineal, yet the gland's work itself remained mysterious until recently. We now know that the pineal gland serves as a key modulator of the entire neurohormone system, gearing us to adapt to shifting environmental conditions. The pineal gland is light sensitive, allowing the brain to perceive the time of day. A preclinical experiment reported in the Journal of Science in 1968 determined that melatonin administration raises brain serotonin levels. In turn, melatonin levels increase when serotonin is given. Melatonin and serotonin interact, sometimes intensifying each other's effect on the body, at other times opposing each other. While scientists disagree about serotonin's effect on body temperature, it is clear that melatonin produces cooling, which, as I discussed in Chapter 3, is a key stress-relieving function. Dr. Norden goes on to explain evidence of the benefits of melatonin in psychiatry, and also effects on melatonin and aging, showing that pineal extracts given to animals increase their lifespan, as well as the fact that melatonin production decreases quite dramatically with age. He also goes on to explain the links between melatonin and fighting cancer, in that melatonin has an effect on boosting the immune system. He then goes on about how to raise your melatonin levels. The thing is that in this he talks nothing about changing your perception, changing your behavior, changing the way you think in any way. He doesn't talk about increasing your creativity, increasing your happiness, increasing your self-confidence, or trying to do that to other people. All he talks about is food and dietary ways of changing, trying to increase your melatonin levels. After that, he goes straight on to melatonin supplements. Now, this book is notable for a number of reasons. One thing is that HarperCollins, in addition to producing Beyond Prozac, which promotes psychiatry and psychiatric drugs, they also produce another series called their Aquarian series, which are a series of New Age books. Their book, Understanding Auras, does talk about the pineal as well. but it says some things that are completely different. They also talk about chakras, which are a Vedic scientific concept based on energy centers along the vertebral axis. They include the crown chakra, brown chakra, throat chakra, heart chakra, abdominal chakra, and one or two sacral chakras. Chakras have been very badly misunderstood, and books like Understanding Auras haven't helped. Chakras are short, squat, swirling mini tornadoes of color strung in an orderly line along the spine from the top of the head to the tailbone. They are energy whirlpools where incoming energy is processed and distributed and where outgoing is cannoned outward to where it must go. The student of metaphysics usually concentrates on seven of these centers. There are actually many more chakras besides the major seven, and these are called minor chakras. These minor energy centers can be found in our hands and feet, at each breast, in each knee and elbow, at the hips and shoulders, and even at the ankle bones. There has been much written about the chakras in the last 2,000 years, and for the student who wishes to know more about these centers, I refer you to these volumes. For our purposes here, namely the understanding of ourselves through the study of the aura, I will briefly describe the location and general function of each of the major chakras. But having the general idea of what goes on at each given center and locating the disruption or activity in the auric layers near that center, we can put the two elements together and get a more precise picture of the mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual health of the subject. Some of these centers I see with my physical eyes, although they are usually faint and I have to rely on my inner eye, as well as explanations from guides and my higher mind to get a clear picture of how they are functioning. It is not actually important to actually see these centers in analyzing the aura. If one sees a disruption or a helping ray near the fifth chakra, throat chakra, for example, one only has to know that the fifth chakra is the center of communication, and depending on the meaning of the colors of the disruption or ray, can assume that the root of the activity is in the area of communication, that is, communication with others or oneself. Traditionally, any listing of chakras starts at the root chakra. Also called the first chakra, it is the center where our most primitive autonomic systems are fed their energies, systems that regulate our will to live or the power to operate our immune system, in other words, our basic survival mechanisms. This is, in fact, not true. Most listings of the chakras, including Vedic concepts, as well as American Indian Hopi concepts, list the chakras from the crown chakra. People should be guided by their concepts of conscience, of ideas of good and bad, of truth, of honesty, of goodness and kindness to other people. These are principles in both Hopi philosophy as well as Vedic philosophy. It's to do with wisdom and understanding and perception. None of this is discussed in this book. They direct people to their first chakra, as they describe it, which they are referring to the sacral chakra, which is the antithesis of Vedic philosophy. They continue. The first chakra is found at the base of the spine between the sacrum and the coccyx or tailbone. When disruptions are seen in the auric layers near this chakra, the subjects could be suffering, depending on the degrees of disruption, from deep insecurities or immune system malfunctions such as AIDS and related diseases. They may display outward symptoms such as greed, theft, or a feeling that the world is pushing them around and they have to fight back. They are frightened and they feel there isn't enough to go around. Disruptions at this center will create a compulsive personality who is unable to find rest even when surrounded by positive happenings. The basic animal sexual drives are rooted here as well.